I think I'm on it. There we go. Take your Bibles. We're going to be over in 1 Samuel chapter 2. Appreciate you guys being here this morning. I hope that you've come with a heart to worship the Lord and a heart to receive some encouragement, instruction from His Word. And ultimately that when we leave here today, we will know that we have met with the Lord. That's my prayer today, and I hope that is yours as well. I want to talk to you a little bit this morning. We're going to look at a little bit of the life of Samuel, one of my favorite characters in Scripture. I had an opportunity to spend some time a couple years back going through the whole study of 1 Samuel with our class, and there's just some really good principles in 1 Samuel that just always resonated in my mind. And so when Pastor asked me, he didn't really ask me, he told me I was preaching today. It wasn't really a request, it was more, "You're preaching today." And in fact, when staff meeting was happening, and I was looking at the calendar and realizing he was taking his vacation right now, I looked at him and I said, "Don't make me preach right when I get back from vacation." And he said, "Well," and he looked at Brother Paul, and Brother Paul's eyes got that big, and he looked back at me and said, "You're preaching." So anyway, here I am. So I went back to some passages and stories that I'm really familiar with, that I love to look at in the Word of God, and Samuel is one of those for me. And so we're going to be in chapter 2, but I'll have to give you some, rather than jump right in, we'll have to do a little bit of background here in just a minute. But here's kind of the thought for today is, whether you realize it or not, you are defined predominantly by your behaviors and or your actions. And often they're different than what we personally perceive them to be. But if you were to ask somebody else around you how they would define you or what perception they had of you, there's usually one or two things that come to everybody's mind, regardless of who you are. You are known for the things you like or the things you do. For example, I shared a couple of weeks ago with our young marrieds class. I had several of our older, wiser men and women come and teach for a series, and one of the men, actually all of them, as I prayed about it and decided who to have, but one of them was Brother Mark Stripling and his wife, Miss Sharon. And what I told the class then was, there's a couple of things that stick out in my mind about these men, and particularly Brother Mark is he's a servant. You will always see Brother Mark busy about serving. He has a servant's heart, and that's one of the things here at Southwinds that stick out to me when I think of Brother Mark. I also think of a man who loves the church. He loves the church dearly. The Church of God, Southwinds in particular, is very near and dear to his heart. You can tell that if you're around Brother Mark any length of time, you will know those two things. Now, you may know some other things, too, that you don't like, but those two things you will know very quickly. I think a Brother Scott Key. Well, that's a whole other story, but I had positive things to say a while ago until he told me a minute ago that he told his class heaven is on Mars, and that's a whole other story. I'm like, I don't know who we have teaching our classes around here. But I know this about Brother Scott Key. Brother Scott Key loves, I don't know if he loves Arkansas. He claims Arkansas is his home, by the way. Being in Branson, I met some of your fellow Arkans, whatever they are. I don't have a lot of good things to say, so I'm kidding. But I know this, Brother Mark is a very sober-minded person who, if you need some counsel, he's a good man to go to. He loves the Lord, he loves Scripture, loves his wife and his family. He's a great man of God. These are things that we know about people. Now, there's a lot more to these men, and of course, we could go on and on and on, but here's my point. There's a lot more that make us up, but we are predominantly known by one or two, maybe three things to the people around us because of the things that we're passionate about or the things that we do, the things that we say. That's what we're known for. Good or bad, that's how it is. Now, as believers, here's what I've come to know. As believers, we often act contrary to who or what God has made us to be, because we are often known by our outward behaviors rather than what's really inside. And there's a lot to that, but here's my idea with this. Here's the example I'm thinking of. In Corinthians, when you think of the church at Corinth, what do we know them for? We know them as being a carnal church. We know them as being a very sinful church, a church that was very wicked in a lot of its practices and things that they engaged themselves in. And yet, at the first, at the opening, the second verse of the first chapter of Corinthians, Paul says this, "Unto the church of God, which is at Corinth, to them that are sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints, with all that in every place call upon the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, both theirs and ours." Right off the bat, even though we know them as a wicked church, Paul is calling them the church of God, who are sanctified, called to be his saints. Now, That doesn't sound like somebody that's about to rebuke a church, but here's the point. What we know them for is different than who they were supposed to be. They were supposed to be separated unto the Lord, and yet they were acting contrary to that. Now, here's the good news. This is where I'm going with this. We get to choose what we are known for. We get to choose who people perceive us to be. That's our choice. Whether we want to admit that or not, the way people view us really is our choice as much as it is their choice, because we get to choose what we're passionate about. We get to choose the outward behaviors. And Samuel is a great example of a man who chose faith in God above the consequences or the circumstances that he found himself in. He always chose to have faith in God. And so today I want to talk to you a little bit about this idea of we always have a choice when it comes to our relationship with the Lord. Now, the background is this before we jump into chapter 2. In chapter 1, you're probably familiar with this, but Hannah has been praying for a son. She wants her womb has been barren. She is praying to the Lord. They go yearly to sacrifice like they're supposed to, and they're at the temple and at Shiloh, and they're praying, as she is specifically praying, that the Lord would answer her prayer to give her a son. Well, chapter 1, God answers that prayer and tells her through the priest there that she will have a son to go back and be faithful, and that's exactly what she does. Her promise to God, if he will give her a son, is that she will return him to the Lord. I will have him serve you all the days of his life if you will just give me a son. So in chapter 2, at the beginning of it, their family, it's been several years now, Samuel is her firstborn and that God has given her. They are going back to the temple several years later. He's still a young boy, but they're going back to fulfill her commitment, her promise unto the Lord. So let's pick up the story in 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 11. And Elkanah, who is her husband, went to Ramah to his house, and the child did minister unto the Lord before Eli the priest. So the family goes back to the temple as they're supposed to. They leave him, and Elkanah, the dad, the husband, takes the family, and they return to their home in Ramah and live their lives as they leave the child there to minister to the Lord before the priest Eli. Now, Samuel, as you read the rest of the story, will become one of Israel's greatest leaders. He will become a very pivotal character in the history of Israel. Am I bumping this? Is that what's making that? I hope that's not too distracting. So, but here's what, as we read the story of Samuel, particularly here at the beginning of his life, I wonder, now, he becomes this great leader, and I don't think Samuel has any idea that he's about to become a great leader. But I do wonder, being from the mind and the eyes of a child, I wonder if he ever thought, as he's watching his family vanish down the road back to their home on their camels and donkeys or whatever they traveled on, I wonder if Samuel ever thought, don't I get a say in this? Don't I get a choice in this? I don't know that I really want you to drop me off at the church and leave me. But we don't ever hear Samuel question that. But I can't help but think that in his mind, perhaps, and maybe he didn't, but I know I would, wondering, I don't have a choice in where you leave me. I don't have a choice of what I have to do. I don't even know these people that I have to serve. Why would you do this to me? And I wonder, have you ever felt that way? Have you ever felt like the circumstances in your life have been one of those things where you just say, I don't understand what's going on. It's not fair. Well, I don't have to ask that question, because we all feel that way at times. We all feel like we don't have a choice. I know kids in particular, I know my children feel this way sometimes, that they don't get a say in anything. And as they've gotten older, they do get a little bit more say. But when they were young, I know they didn't like some of the choices we made, where we lived, the cities we moved to. I know that they hated some of the moves we made, because the Lord, I felt as the dad, was leading us somewhere. They didn't like that. But they didn't get a say. I didn't really ask them, what do you want to do? Now, I included them in the process, but ultimately, it was going to be my decision, not theirs. And I know there were times they were frustrated. I know there were times that they were like, Dad, what are you doing? They didn't get to choose the school they went to. We decided that. My wife and I prayed about where we would send our kids to school. That was our choice, being the parents and the leaders of the home. I know sometimes children feel like, I never get a say. I know that sometimes kids wish they could be in a different family, or they could live in a different town, or they could have a different wealth status. I know kids feel that way sometimes. And sometimes kids, I know that it can be frustrating, that sometimes you feel like, I just don't have a say. I don't have the ability, the opportunity to speak my mind, and I just want to have my way once in a while. That's a natural feeling. What you do with that is something different. We'll talk about that. But it's not just kids who sometimes feel that way. As adults, we feel that way. Man, I tell you right now, there's some things that are frustrating that as an adult in our society that I watch, particularly the direction that our nation's going. Sometimes I get frustrated. I feel like I don't have a say. Why are things going this direction? This is not what is good for our country. And we could go on down the list, but the reality is simply this, that what I want to learn today, we'll get to my first point here, is I want us to learn and be reminded of this, that no matter what our situation is, we always have a choice. We still always have a choice, no matter what it seems is taking place, because my response is my responsibility. That's something we learned in our young marrieds class. My response is always my responsibility. That's my choice. How I respond is my responsibility. I get to choose that. Now, I may not get to choose other things, but I can choose some things personally of how I'm going to handle certain circumstances and situations. That's what Samuel does. That's what we want to learn today, is in different situations, how can I choose things that are right and good and righteous before the Lord? Well, let's look first of all here. We're going to cover quite a bit of passage here. And so I'm going to read a little bit and then explain, and we'll read a little bit more and explain some more things here. But the first thing I want to notice in 1 Samuel chapter 2, we're going to begin in verse 11, or in verse 12. We'll go back up to verse 11. It says, Elkanah went to Ramah to his house, and the child did minister unto the Lord before Eli the priest. And then he tells the story. The story goes on and tells basically the environment that they were leaving their son with. It says, now the sons of Eli is the priest, his sons were the sons of Belial. Let me just say, that's not a good thing. They knew not the Lord. And the priest's custom with the people was that when any man offered sacrifice, the priest's servant came with the flesh was seething, with a flesh hook of three teeth in his hand, and he struck it into the pan or the kettle or the cauldron or the pot. All that the flesh had brought up with the priest took for himself. So they did in Shiloh unto all the Israelites that came thither. Now, I'm going to explain the story that's going on, but the first thing I want you to see is Samuel, in the midst of this negative, bad situation, Samuel chose to have a good attitude. And let me explain what I mean by that. In verse 11 and then verse 18, we didn't read that far. It says that Samuel, in the midst of a negative situation, ministered before the Lord. What I hear from that when I read that passage is this. The first aspect of his attitude was that he had a servant's heart. Regardless of what was going on around Samuel, Samuel continued to minister. That's what that word means, to serve. He continued to serve in a place that everybody else was demanding to be served. There's a contrast that takes place here. First Samuel, I wonder as a young child, what did he do to serve in the temple? I don't really know. I kind of speculate a few things. Maybe as a small boy, maybe he was given charge to watch over the candle to make sure it was lit when it was supposed to be lit and put out when it was supposed to be put out. Probably he was a gopher. That's what we used to call him. He was a waiter. Whatever Eli wanted, that's what Samuel got to do. Go get me a cup of coffee. Okay, yes, sir. And give me something to eat, or go do this, go take care of this and take care of these things. Whatever Eli determined Samuel needed to do, that's what Samuel did. And it says throughout his life here, we can read over and over again, these words are said about Samuel. He ministered unto the Lord. He continued to have that servant spirit. He continued to display this idea of being a servant rather than somebody that wants to be served. Now look at this in contrast. Now, that may not be a big deal until you look at the contrast here, because in that same household are two men by the name of Hophni and Phinehas. And what we just read there, basically here's the story. These two men, being the sons of the priest, also held a pretty high position in the priesthood. And when people would come, when the Israelites would come to the temple to offer their sacrifices, there was a certain, back in the book of Leviticus, it gives, and we won't go there today, but it gives an outline or a detailed a way that the sacrifices were supposed to be performed. Well, Hophni and Phinehas were not waiting for those processes to be done. Instead, when these sacrifices were being offered, part of it was they would boil the meat, part of it they would cut off the fat, and they would do different things to it. Well, the priest would send their servants while the people of Israel were trying to make their sacrifices, and they would take this flesh hook and they would stick it down in the cauldron, or they'd yank it off the altar, and they would say, this is for the priest. And whatever came out, this was for the priest. And if the people said, no, wait a minute, you can have whatever you want, just let us do what God has commanded us to do, they'd say, you're going to give it to me or I'll take it by force. Welcome to church. That's what they were doing. They were demanding to be served. You see the contrast here? We have on one side, we have Samuel, who is a servant spirit, watching all of this take place. And then you have Hophni and Phinehas, who are demanding that the people serve them the way that they want to be served, not according to what God wants, but according to what their own fleshly desires were. And that's what Samuel was growing up around. That's what Samuel saw, and yet he decided, in spite of all that, in spite of the Hophnis and Phinehases of the world, I'm going to continue to have a minister-servant spirit with what God has given me to do. Now, let me step out here just for a minute, because I want us to understand that it is so important for us today to teach servant-minded children, or to teach our children to have a servant spirit. It is so important in the day and age we live in. That is a thing that is of the past. One of the shows that my wife and I went to go see was Jonah at Sight and Sound Theater. If you've not been, that's a really cool place to go in Branson. And it was the story of Jonah. And of course, we know the story of Jonah, but that's not the point today. They have an intermission time. And so I took, they have an hour part, and then you take a break for 15 minutes, and they come back and do the second half of the show. And so during that time, my wife went to get something to drink and use the restroom and all those things that you have to do after sitting there for an hour and wait in the line that's around the corner. So me, wanting to not sit down where we were at, I got up and went to kind of halfway to the back where the soundboard was at, and I just stood there. I just stretching my legs, and I just leaned up against one of the counters there. And I'm watching, of course, just being a people watcher a little bit, so just kind of, anybody else a people watcher, by the way? I just like to watch people. It's kind of entertaining a little bit sometimes. And so, of course, people are passing in front of me. And there's this, she appeared to be a single mother. She may not have been. She was there alone with probably, if I remember right, 5 kids. And she had kind of a scowl on her face. I'll just leave it at that. She just didn't look very happy. And so I'm watching. I'm right on the center aisle, and there's another gentleman coming around the corner, and her kids are bustling around, and they're bumping into people. And one of the kids, he's probably 6, 7, 8, somewhere in there, he turns around and runs into the man as he's coming around the corner. And the kid surprised me. He apologized to the young man. I say it was not so much a surprise. It was a good thing for him to do. But what surprised me is the mom turned around and looked and said, "You don't apologize. He needs to apologize to you. He ran into you." And I watched the whole thing. I'm like, whoa, I don't know what just happened there. And here's what my takeaway from that was. I'm thinking, especially as I'm going through this passage here, I'm thinking, we've lost a whole attitude of this, or what we've gained is an attitude of, it's all about me. And to watch a mother teach her child, now we would never claim to do it this directly, but she was teaching her child that life is all about you, everybody else gets out of the way. That's what she was teaching her young child. I'm afraid that we're raising a generation. Now, that's one example, but here's what I'm afraid of. As I watch in public places, and you probably see it too, we're raising a generation of Hophni and Phinehases. That's really what, if you look around in culture today, we are raising a generation of people that are demanding their rights, their entitlements, and I will tell you, that goes against Scripture. We have to be very careful and very diligent as believers to teach our young people to have servant spirits, to have a servant heart, to have a servant attitude. And we can blame it on culture all we want, but the reality is Samuel is in the midst of a very negative situation, and yet Samuel over and over again chooses to be a servant and a minister unto the Lord. It can be done. We have to be very diligent about it. And so I'm looking at it, I'm like, how did Samuel develop that? How did Samuel develop this heart, that understanding that one day the greatest among us is going to be a servant? And I think it boils down to simply this, is he had to have learned it from his parents. The short time he's in the home, he had to have that instilled in his heart by either his dad or his mom or the setting that was there. But how do we teach that now today? Well, we could spend a lot of time on that today. I'm not going to do that. But can I just say that the house of God is a good place to start? Having your kids at this place and involved in this body of believers, that's a good place to start. To get them involved in serving somewhere, not being served. Great place to, I'm really going out on a limb here, but a great place to do that is fellowships. Have your kids serve. Have your kids be a part of something, clean something up, do something that puts others in front of themselves. Teach them to serve. Have that servant, humble spirit. Because what we see here is that because of his attitude of having this selfless heart, God raises him up later. Well, here's the other thing I see in his attitude that he chose. Not only did he have a servant's heart, he had a teachable spirit. Look here again at verse 22. We'll drop down a little bit more. As all this is taking place in chapter 2, verse 22, it says that Eli was, we're kind of jumping around in the story a little bit. You may have to go back and read it to get the whole context. But in verse 22, it kind of jumps forward a little bit, and it says that Eli was very old, and he heard all that his sons did unto Israel. You know, all that story we just talked about. And how that they lay with the women that assembled at the door of the tabernacle of the congregation. And so he pulls them aside, verse 23 says, and he says unto them, "Why do you do such things? For I hear of your evil dealings by all this people. Nay, my sons, for it is no good report that I hear. You make the Lord's people to transgress. If one man sin against another, the judge shall judge him. But if a man sin against the Lord, who shall entreat for him? Notwithstanding, they hearken not unto the voice of their father, because the Lord would slay them. But look at verse 26. The child Samuel grew on and was also in favor with the Lord and also with men. So we see in verse 25 and verse 26 that Eli, he knows what's going on with his sons. And yet over and over again, as he hears these atrocities that they're committing towards God's people and actually causing the people of God to sin, he turns a blind eye until somewhere along in his life, apparently he's confronted to the point that he has to do something. He has to pull his kids aside and say, why are you doing this? And what do they respond with? Nothing. They turn a deaf ear to their father. They ignore everything that he's telling them. And he just kind of leaves it at that. We could say maybe he gave him a slap on the wrist here. That's about all he does. Now, that's a whole other story. We won't have time to go there today. But in contrast to that, we see Samuel doing the opposite. He continues on a path contrary to the direction of Hophni and Phinehas. And so we can deduce from this passage that Samuel had a heart to learn. What we see from Hophni and Phinehas, they didn't have a teachable spirit. Don't tell me what to do, Dad. Don't tell me not to go get the meat that I want. Which, by the way, when you read the passage, they're doing nothing but indulging themselves in things that they would delight in. And they've learned it from their father, by the way. But again, that's a whole nother story. But they've watched their father. They've watched the priesthood go down the tubes. And they've taken it upon themselves to do whatever they want. The Bible goes on here to say, it gives this specific example that it was the custom of the priesthood to do this. I'm going to talk about that in just a minute. But here's the reality. They had allowed their culture to dictate what they wanted to do, and nobody was going to tell them to do anything differently than what they wanted to. And in the midst of that, Samuel says, I'll learn. You can instruct me. Lord, you can instruct me through the priest. Even if it's a corrupt priesthood, I can still learn from that. And Samuel chose to have a teachable, humble spirit. Let me tell you, this is so important. We have got to instill in our young people today a teachable spirit, a willingness to learn the Bible, a willingness to learn how to be productive adults as they grow into adulthood, how to be godly men and women when they grow up. And I thought about this. How do we do that? How do we teach our kids to have a teachable spirit? And I really pondered this for a while as I was on the road a lot this week, and I could spend a whole message right there. We're not going to do that. But here's the question that popped into my mind that has to be answered. Before we can answer the question, how do we teach people to have a teachable spirit, we got to answer the question, what keeps us from having a teachable spirit to begin with? And I believe the answer to that is just pure, simple pride. Why don't we like to hear a different way of doing something? Well, most of the time because we like the way we do it. And we don't want anybody to tell us to do it any way different. And when somebody does, they're wrong, I'm right, I don't want to hear it. So let's just give a really quick thought of how do we teach young people to have a teachable spirit. Well, adults, we have to have one ourselves. We have to be willing to be taught. We have to be willing to realize, I don't know everything. There's some things spiritually that I need help with sometimes. There's some things at work that I don't understand that I need to go and get some understanding. We got to really quit being so stubborn about our preferences and about the things that we think we know and be willing to be taught ourselves. About a year or two ago, I picked up a book called The IY Generation. I've referenced it a couple times in the past, trying to understand that generation that's between 18 and about 28 right now. If you're between 18 and 28 today, right here, raise your hand. Let me see if we got. Okay, so we got, you're known as, that's not a bad thing. You go ahead. Everybody's going, I think I am, but he's going to call on me and make fun of me. I'm not going to make fun of you. But here's what, part of that, well, no promises. Okay, so that's what's known as the IY generation. And every generation is different. I know my parents thought our generation was crazy, and your parents thought your generation was nuts, and there's some truth to that. But here's one of those characteristics that we're known for in the IY generation. They're very sociable people. They love people. There's very few social and ethnic boundaries. In other words, there's not the boundaries of race and background and religion. Those have kind of faded by. There's not those strong preferences of I don't like this race or I don't like this culture. That's kind of gone by the wayside. And I think that's a good thing to some degree. But here's also another characteristic that they're known for. They seek very little advice, and the advice they seek is from their peers. That's not a good thing. And I've been around teenagers and that generation enough to see. Now here's there's some more to tag on to that thought. The question is, why don't they? And sometimes it's because we haven't taught them very well. We've taught them the wrong way, which is as another perspective. But let me just encourage you, if you're in that generation, maybe even if you're beyond that generation, be willing to seek the counsel of those that have gone before you. Be willing to have a teachable spirit. There's some people that maybe you aren't even aware they have the wisdom that they have because you're not willing to go seek it out. There's some people right here in this room that have depths of knowledge that can give you understanding to keep you on a path to save you a lifetime of troubles if you'll just simply ask. Have a teachable spirit. So the first thing I see is, first of all, if we want to instruct our kids to have a teachable spirit, we got to have one. We got to exemplify that in our own life. And the second thing is, when we do instruct them properly, not provoking them to wrath. I think sometimes we have doomed the other generation because they don't feel like they can do anything right, so they don't want to seek any other answers. So be careful with that balance. So let me move on here because I'm taking a little more time than I meant to. But Samuel, in his situations, could have complained, he could have argued, he could have been frustrated, he could have said, this is not right, I didn't get to choose this life, I don't want to be at the church, I don't want to be a servant to the priesthood, but he didn't do any of that. Instead, he chose to have a good attitude, which led to my second thought here, is his good attitude led to good actions. He chose his actions. He could have done a lot of things, but Samuel was careful to choose the right actions. Because I thought about this, listen to this carefully. A proper attitude will always lead to proper behavior. If you have the right attitude about whatever situation you're in, you will do the right thing. If you have the wrong attitude, you'll never do the right thing. If you walk into a situation that you're unhappy and you're frustrated, whether it's in your family, whether it's in the church, whether it's at work, whatever the case is, if you walk in with the wrong attitude, you're going to do the wrong thing almost every single time. But if you back up and you take a breath and you say, okay, hold on a minute, Lord, I want to have the right attitude here. I want to exemplify you with a teachable spirit and a humble heart. I'm going to go in here with those things in mind. 9 times out of 10, you're going to do the right thing. You're going to act the right way. You're going to exemplify the right behaviors. And that's what Samuel does here, is he had chosen the right attitude, which led to a right behavior. The first thing I see with him is he denies himself. That's the first action that I see Samuel taking. Look back at verse 13 and 14. We've already read it, but let's look back there. It says that the priest's custom with the people was that when any man offered sacrifice, the priest's servant came and basically took whatever he wanted. That phrase, the priest's custom was. In other words, it had become socially acceptable for the priesthood to do whatever they wanted. Now, the people didn't like it. They were just powerless to do anything about it, but it was socially acceptable in the priesthood to do whatever you wanted. In that little room of priests, and as they would sit around, and the leaders of the tabernacle, they could decide whatever they wanted, and they could do whatever they wanted, and nobody cared. Nobody checked them with their behaviors. If Hophni decided he wanted a prime rib off of that shoulder of that lamb that the guy was offering for sacrifice, he could do whatever he wanted, and nobody would question him. It was acceptable for him to do whatever he wanted. It was wrong, but socially it was acceptable. They had all decided, basically, you determine what's right in your own eyes. Now, as I said, in Leviticus, there was a very strong command of God of how to do that, and they were violating everything that God had commanded. But what's taking place here is just self-centeredness on the behalf of Hophni and Phinehas. Now, here's obviously a quick little application that I think we can take from this. It was socially acceptable there to do whatever they wanted, and I find that same thing taking place in our culture today. There's a lot of things that have become socially acceptable that shouldn't be socially acceptable. There are a lot of things in our culture, especially in our high schools and junior highs that are coming up now. It's getting younger and younger. You hear us talk about it all the time. But there are certain behaviors that have just become okay. In other words, there are some relationships, maybe I can put it that way, that have now become socially acceptable. In fact, they've gone to the point of, if you don't accept these certain behaviors and relationships, you're a hateful bigot that doesn't belong on the face of the earth. Here's a good example. I'm going to be just getting myself in trouble here, so we're just going to do it. I'm trying to be tactful, but I can't be. So about a year or so ago, I noticed when we jumped into this new administration, or the same administration, second 4 years, I was teaching over on a Wednesday night in the book of Romans, and of course the first chapter of Romans talks about homosexuality over and over again, and we talked about that a little bit. And that was at the same time that this election was taking place, and that they were about to do the inauguration, and If you remember, there was a pastor who was going to pray over the inauguration who was removed from that because of some strong beliefs he had against homosexuality. And instead what they did is they had a female pastor who was a lesbian pray for the presidency. And then that same week, there were some other things that took place. And that week, there were three, we don't have time to go back there, but that week alone, there were three strong messages sent from our government that homosexuality was not only okay, it was the way things are going. And we were supposed to just accept that. We were just supposed to say, okay, it's socially acceptable. Now guess what? One of my favorite sports to watch is football. I can't hardly watch it anymore because of the things that have taken place. And I've listened to callers call in frustrated about pushing that agenda. And without exception, all of these talk shows that I enjoy listening to on the sports talk radio, if you bring up anything negative about homosexuality, they will land blast you. Because that is what media wants us to swallow. That is what is socially acceptable. Let me tell you, it is not socially acceptable in the eyes of God. And I'm not saying that just to get you amen, but I want you to understand something. Our nation is on a slippery slope of things becoming socially acceptable that should never be socially acceptable. That's just one example. We could go on all day. What I want to encourage you to do today is take a look at your own family and say, what things have become socially acceptable in my house that shouldn't be? What things have I decided are okay that God Himself would say that shouldn't even be in your four walls? Because that's the same principle as we're looking at. We're looking at extremes, but the reality is they're only extremes so that we can slide down that slope. We're sliding quickly along with society, and if we're not careful, we're going to follow the way of Hophni and Phinehas. What did Samuel do in the midst of this? Well, he didn't follow what was culturally acceptable. In fact, I think it's verse 18. Look at what he does. There's some symbolism that takes place here. It says, Samuel ministered before the Lord, being a child, girded with a linen ephod. Now, when you first read that, it doesn't seem like there's a lot there, but there's a lot of symbolism taking place in that one little verse there. First, it reminds us again that he's ministering, but that ephod, that linen ephod, was something that designated him as being set apart for the priesthood. So in the midst of all that was taking place, that was an abomination in the eyes of God, Samuel puts on the linen ephod and says, I'll be a minister. I will be what God wants me to be. He's not braggadocious about it, but he makes a very strong statement just with what he wears, saying, I am set apart for God. In the midst of a corrupt priesthood, Samuel says, I will set myself apart. I will purify myself, and I will remain distinct in a culture that is not distinct from this world. Samuel made a conscious choice to put himself apart for the work of God, and he continued to minister before the Lord. So there's some obviously with that symbolism here that we got to move forward and think about. I know, I talked to some of you who have kids in public school. That scares me for you. Not that I'm blasting public school. What it scares me, though, is the culture that they have to face. And it's not just public school, by the way. It's anywhere that society congregates, Christian school, homeschool, wherever your kids are getting together with other people, there's a danger that they're going to take on this same mentality of whatever is okay out there is okay for me. Let me just encourage you as a parent to be diligent. Stand on guard and make sure that your family is not slipping down this slope, going with the flow of whatever culture says is okay, whatever culture says is acceptable. Look to the Word of God to find out what God would have you and your family do. It's easy to slip down that slope. It's easy to do what is socially acceptable. I'll tell you, in ministry, it's a struggle. You look around here in Houston at all these big churches and where everybody chooses to go because of the different things that are taking place that they offer. I tell you, we used to joke in Ponca City, we could build a big church if we just put a casino in the gym. That was the joke that was going on, but it was serious. They were doing that. And you could grow a big church there if all you did was just say gambling's okay, put a casino in the gym, and have people come in. Man, we'd have a multi-million dollar building paid for in a year. It was incredible. We used to joke about that. We never really entertained the thought. But there's a lot of things you can do to grow a church the wrong way. And let me tell you, if you're ever in a ministry that's struggling, you get the temptation once in a while. Hey, you know, if we just do this, if we just drop this standard, if we just do away with this particular topic of preaching, people will come. And you can grow a ministry. And it's hard sometimes to say, nope, this is where God wants us. We stand here. You know what? It's the same way in family, isn't it? You have your kids that they go off to play somewhere. They go and get involved with a group of friends, and before you know it, they're heading down a certain slope. And you're the parent that says, okay, that's not good for my kids. I need you home at this time. You don't need to be going to see that particular movie. I'm sorry that all your friends are doing that. That's a hard stand to take, isn't it? But you know what? That's what God calls us to be. He calls us to remain distinct, to be set apart unto Him and separate from the world. That's what Samuel does here. He continues to minister. He continues to purify himself for the work of the Lord. And because Samuel does that, he chooses his attitude, which chose the right actions. And because I have to have a third A up here, he chose his altitude. And what I really mean by that is his destiny. The direction that God took him was all in direct correlation with the choices that he made as a young child. Because he decided as a young boy, I'm going to separate my life unto him. As a young man, he said, I'm going to serve the Lord regardless of whoever's around me. God lifted him up and made him a great leader. He had no idea that that's what God was going to do. He just simply served the Lord. I just want to be pleasing unto the Lord. I want to separate myself unto him. And God said, there is a young man whose heart I can use to do great things. And God took Samuel and he raised him up and he used him in a mighty way in the history of Israel. In fact, chapter 2, verse 26, it says, Samuel grew on and was found favor both with the Lord and also with men. You know, we look at being distinct and we think, man, if I'm distinct and separated from the Lord, the world's going to think I'm crazy. They're going to think that I'm off my rocker. And there's some truth to that. But you know, if we are consistently choosing the right attitudes and the right actions, eventually, even the lost world looks at our life and goes, there's something different about that person. There's something to be desired about being a Christian. And there's something that is attractive to somebody who separated themselves unto the Lord and given their heart to the Lord to be used by Him in any way they want. Not out of pridefulness or out of a false humility, but a genuine servant spirit, that's attractive. Because it's not out there. It's different. And people look at that and they say, that's what I want in my life. Let me tell you, when you do that and you separate your heart unto the Lord, God will raise you up. He will use you in ways that you never dreamed imaginable. It's a basic principle of leadership. In fact, as you study out the book of Samuel, really it's just a story of the lack of good godly leadership in the nation of Israel. And it parallels where we are as a country today and how important it is that we have good godly leadership who will train up a generation of people who love the Lord and who are willing to be separated unto Him regardless of what the culture says. We need leadership in our homes and in our churches and in our families and in the workplace. We need people who will lead according to the Word of God to make a difference in this world. Not go with the flow, but do something different according to the Word of God. That's what we need in Tomball, Texas, and in Houston, and in America. That's what we need, and that's the only thing that will change this country, that will turn this country back to God. I was reading this last week. I love history, and I picked up a book that I had recommended to somebody that I had read several years ago, and I thought, man, I'm going to read that again. It's the book 1776. If you're a history buff and you haven't read that book, I recommend it. It's literally what it says. It's the story of the year 1776 in the history of America. And it was a time, that particular time frame was a time that was described, you've heard the description by Thomas Paine, it was a time that tried men's souls. And it definitely was a time that our nation's outlook was definitely in question. I wrote his name down here, Henry Knox, who was the chief artillery officer of the Continental Army, wrote in a letter to his wife this statement. And let me give you the background of what has taken place just to remind you in this period of just a couple of months, really, there in 1776. Our Continental Army had won a great battle at Boston and had basically run the English out of the Boston Harbor. But the battle then, or the war, continued up north into the area around New York. We didn't fare so well in that area. In fact, in Brooklyn Heights, where we had, where George Washington had sent part of his troops to defend, literally gave up the ground with hardly a skirmish and retreated across the river at night. You know that great story. And then they gave up New York just weeks later with hardly a fight, maybe not even a fight at all, if I remember. And really, through that period of a couple months, all the Continental Army did was retreat, lose men, 1,000 men captured, 500 men killed. And all of this at the same time as December is approaching, the enlistments of I think two-thirds of the army were up. They could all walk away at any moment. And all of this is what's facing the leader of our nation, George Washington. He's trying to figure out how to fight for freedom with an army that is discouraged and is about to lay down their weapons and walk away. And I think of the pressures that he must have been under to try to lead this nation. And this is what Henry Knox wrote to his wife in a letter. She said, "We want great men who, when fortune frowns, will not be discouraged." And that is so true in our nation. We need people who, when fortune frowns on us, will not be discouraged, but they will have an attitude that says, that's okay, God's still in control. We're still going to move forward. We're still going to do what's right. I don't care what the circumstances are. And here's my point. If it's important in our nation, it's important in our churches. We need men and women who will say, I don't care what the circumstances are, I will not be discouraged. I will not give up the fight. I will not give up what God has asked me to do as a husband, as a father, as a mother, as a parent, or even as a child. I know what God has called me to do, and even though the circumstances are discouraging and overwhelming, I will not be discouraged. That's what we need in Christianity today, because Christianity is under attack. Everywhere that we look today, Christianity is being cast into this light of we're a bunch of bigots, we're a bunch of people that are haters, and all these things that are just not true about Christianity. But that is what we are facing. And so we need men who will lead their families and say, this is what's right. It doesn't matter what society says, but this is what's right. This is what my family will do. We will continue to serve the Lord. We will continue to have a humble heart and a servant spirit. We will continue to do that which what God has called us to do. We need mothers who will say, I will show my kids how to live for the Lord and how to serve Him. We need children who will say, I give my life unto the Lord. I commit myself to Him today to use however He wants to use me. That's what the Church of God needs today. That's what we need at South Winds Baptist Church, is people that say, I don't care what they say out there. God has told me to do this, and this is where I stand. That is the battle that is facing the church today. And here's the promise we have for that. If we choose to do what Samuel chose to do, we choose to have the right attitude and the right actions, God says, I will raise you up. Look here again. He says in verse 30, the Lord saith, be it far from me, for them that honor me, I will honor. But those that despise me shall be lightly esteemed. There's a promise from God that says, if you will do what I ask you to do and you will honor me with your life, I will bless you. But if you don't, I'll let you go your own way. You see, we always have a choice. We can choose to follow the God, the Creator of the heavens and earth, the God that saved my soul, or we can reject Him. It is our choice to do. But with each comes consequences. I don't know about you, but I want the blessing of the Lord on my life. I want the blessing of the Lord on my family's life. I want God's blessing on Southwinds Baptist Church. The only way we get that is we say, today, I choose to have the right attitude towards God. You know what this? Here, one side thought. You know why we fail to have the right attitude? Because we don't trust God's plan. We don't have the faith to believe that God is doing in our circumstances what He wants to do. Go back to Israel. You remember when they're wandering in the wilderness? You know why they were there? They had an evil heart of unbelief. They didn't follow through on God's command because they were afraid, because they didn't have faith that God would carry them through. God has given us similar commands. And the only thing we need to do is have the faith to trust Him. So today, here's my challenge for you. Here's where we want to conclude here, is what are you choosing today? Because when it seems you have no choice, you do have a choice. You can have the right attitude, and that is an attitude of being a servant and a humble-hearted person. That's what God has called us to do, men and women. He's called us to be people who have a heart after Him. And when you choose to have the right attitude, you will more than likely choose the right actions, which is denying yourself, getting rid of the entitlement attitude, and saying, you know what? Life is about serving other people. And when you do that, your destiny will be completely different than the path that you're on today. So that's my challenge. Where are you at today? What are you known for? What is your behavior outwardly? Not who you are on the inside per se, because you may be a child of God, but you can be acting contrary to who God has made you to be. My question for you is, what would you be known for? What are your behaviors? What are your actions? Because they do tell a lot about where you really are. I hope today that you will choose to give your heart and life to God and be the leaders that God has called us to be. Let's stand for prayer. Heavenly Father, we come to you today, Lord. First, we want to say we are grateful, Lord, for examples from your word that show us what you'd have us to be, Lord. And we thank you for the blessings that come by following you. And Lord, we just today, we want to say thank you again for allowing us to be where we are. Lord, as we have heard some truths from your word, though, it's not hard to look around in our society to see that we are lacking good, godly, biblical leadership. Father, I pray that you would stir our hearts to become that. Lord, I pray that you would prompt us to be what we are called to be, and that is your servants. Lord, I pray that you would instill in our hearts that, Lord, we'd be willing to give every ounce of ourselves to you to do with whatever you will. Lord, I pray that you would do that in our hearts, and we ask it in Christ's name. Amen. Sing a verse or two of invitation before we start. I just want to challenge you again. I just want to ask you, if you're a dad here today, have you been leading your family the way that God's Word has told us to? Have you actively been doing that? We need active fathers, not passive fathers. We need active fathers who say, I will engage in this process of raising up another generation. Men, I challenge you. I challenge you. If you've not been actively involved in that, commit today to the Lord. I will do whatever it takes. Of course, if today, if you're here and you have not accepted Christ as your Savior, it all really begins there. If you don't know the Lord as your Savior, you'll never choose the right attitude. You'll never choose the right actions. You need to choose Christ first. So today, I know we haven't hit on this, but if you don't know Christ as your Savior, if you've not come to Him and confessed your sins to Him and asked Him to forgive you and be the Lord of your life, why don't you come forward today? And we'll show you from God's Word how you can know that Christ is your King and how heaven is your home, and your life will be totally different when you leave here today. If you've not done that, you come and choose Him today. We'll sing a verse or two of invitation, and if the Lord's laid on your heart, you come.
All to Jesus I surrender, all to Him I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him in His presence daily. Jesus, I surrender, humbly at His feet I bow. Worldly pleasures all forsaken, take me, Jesus, take me now. I surrender
be seated. I want to say thank you again for being here today. It's been a good day in God's house. I hope that you've been encouraged. It's been a good week. God has laid on the hearts of some of our young people to be saved. We're looking forward to sharing more of that with you tonight and in the days to come as we talk with those young people. We've had others come interested in salvation or making a profession of salvation. Got one that's come to be baptized here in a few minutes. It's a good day. It's a good day to worship the Lord. I hope that it's an encouraging day to you. Well, now it's time to take the offering. Our ushers are ready. You guys come, and I just encourage you to give as the Lord has blessed you. Give with a cheerful heart today, and then when we're finished, they'll come. We'll have a word of prayer. Thank you.
bless this offering. We pray that you would help us to use it wisely. We pray this in Jesus' name.
All right, I'm going to give you a couple of announcements while they're preparing for baptism, which, by the way, this is Brother Chris's first baptism. So he's a little nervous, but it'll be all good. We've talked through, so excited for him. He's getting to participate in one of the church ordinances, and that's always an encouragement to a young minister. But let me give you a couple things to think about today. This afternoon from 3 to 5 is a wedding shower for Trevor and Molly, and they're not over here today. They're overworking in kids' church, but for those of you that know, they have just been married a short time, and I'll give you a quick little background on Molly. She grew up in the same church that she was born and raised in. Her parents were teenagers in that same church, and it's a small town south of Chicago, so coming to Tomball was a big deal for her. And she's already been encouraged by you as a church family taking her in. That's a big deal. And I appreciate that as a father-in-law, that you guys have been so welcoming to her. And so I appreciate you guys coming today as well, just to be a part of celebrating their wedding. We're excited for them. And so that's from 3 to 5 in the fellowship hall. The details are there in the bulletin. And then also our second quarter financial reports are ready. So if you'd like to pick up a copy of those, you can see our ushers. I didn't verify that with them. Pastor Andy emailed me, so I hope that is the case. If you need some details about that, you got some questions, you can see Brother Billy Petty. He can give you any further information that you might need, but you can pick that up from one of the ushers. And then also Brother Chris has got a lock-in scheduled for August 8th and 9th. The cost there is $25. Its theme is Clash of the Clans. If you're over 25, you probably have no idea what that is. I don't know what that is. It's something to do with, I don't even know what it has to do with. So Clash of the Clans, lock in, has some preaching, good food, that kind of thing. And he says no sleep, so I won't be there. But also tonight we do plan on having our His Design class, even though we'll do camp testimony. So for those young marrieds, come on over. I've got a guest tonight going to speak again to you guys. I know that it'll be encouragement to you. So make sure you're here tonight. All right, I think we're ready. Brother Chris? Does he look even bigger up there? It's kind of frightening. I'm glad he's got a good spirit. So, all right, it's been a good day in the Lord's house. Let's stand. We'll be dismissed in order to pray.